We all say we want to have a blessed life, but what does that really mean? Is it simply having a nice car, a big house, new clothes? What if a blessed life isn't what you think? What if it's more about what you give away than what you hold on to? What if it's more about the contents of your heart than the contents of your bank account? How do we really live the blessed life?
In our second week on the blessed life, and I'm really excited about this message for several reasons, this series, because really it's God's intention for all of us to be blessed. And before you get scared, because I used to get scared when I heard messages like, oh no, one of these prosperity churches. I knew I didn't like this. I thought the church was okay, but now they're getting to the prosperity gospel. Well, we're not about prosperity gospel in the realm of the abuse of the prosperity gospel, where you blab it and you grab it, you confess and you possess. It's all about what I can get out of God instead of what I can give God. So we're not talking about that. I'm going to tell you ahead of time in case you're getting worried. But really, seriously, God wants us to be blessed. Being blessed is having God's purposes realized in your life. That God is your designer. He's your love. He's a lover of your soul. He's your father. He made you. He knows what's best for you, and he wants you to prosper. He wants us to prosper. He really does. And really, prosperity is different in the kingdom of God than what we think in our natural world. We'll be talking about that today. And so one of the gifts we're going to give you is something called The Blessed Life. I had an opportunity to spend a little time with the pastor who wrote this book. Great, great pastor, Robert Morris in Southlake, Texas. One of the mega, huge, everything's bigger in Texas. And he wrote a great book called The Blessed Life. And it really is one of the best I've read because it really is balanced. It talks about giving. Not you don't give to get, but you give to give because God loves us, and this is a great stuff. And so a lot of what we're talking about is in part on this, but really it comes from the Bible, and that's what we're doing. So I encourage you. This is a gift, and we ask you to take one per family. Feel free to take one per family. And right as you leave here today, on your right-hand side, there is a desk, information desk. Please take it as our gift to you. We'd love to have you take it, okay? That's what's going on. So today we're talking about the blessed life and what it means to be blessed. And God wants you to be blessed. I think a lot of us have the idea that, unfortunately, that God is up there in heaven and he's kind of ticked off with you. He's like a parent that's just had it. It's the end of the day, and little Johnny and little Susie have been arguing all day in the car driving to grandma's house. And dad is about ready to take out his paddle. He's had it. And there's one more peep out of there, you're going to get yours. And a lot of people think that's what God's like. That God's in heaven, and man, I don't want you blessed. I'm ticked off at you. You might get to heaven, but I'm not going to like it. I mean, we almost had this idea that God is up there in heaven just ticked off with everybody. But that's not what God wants. God wants relationship. He wants us to know him and to experience the fullness of himself. Unfortunately, we run after other things that take the place of him, and that grieves God. But the truth is, God wants you to be blessed. Every single person in the world has the opportunity to be blessed by God. The invitation is out there. And to be blessed comes by having a personal relationship with the creator of all the universe. And so today we're going to look at it, what it means to be blessed and how to break freedom from the chokehold of mammon. What on earth is mammon? Well, mammon would be riches. Mammon is what would control our lives. The things, you know, ever feel like you live for the bills? You just live for the pills. Not the pills, the bills. And you know the bills make you want to take pills, right? But, you know, you're just living for the bills. It seems like all I'm doing is paying off stuff. Maybe you have credit card debt. Maybe you have this or the other, and every time you're talking to somebody or you try to have a good time, you're thinking about the credit card debt, the debt you have, your college debt, the car debt, the house debt, whatever it is. You just feel like you're so poor, you can't even pay attention. I mean, you ever feel that way? It gets to the point where you're just so torn apart because you're thinking about the bills and thinking about money, and you're like, it's not fair. These other people not even serving God, and look what she's wearing. Look how beautiful she is. Look at all the plastic surgery she has. You make that excuse, if someone's over 50 and looks good, it must be plastic surgery. No, it may not be. A lot of us need to do plastic surgery, by the way. You know what plastic surgery is? You get your credit cards and chop them up. That's what you call good plastic surgery. But you know, you look at somebody and you see everything, they're prospering, they're doing well, and you're like, God, I don't understand. I'm following you. I go to church, and where is the blessing in my life? My kids are running around. They're not following you. I'm single. I can't find anyone to marry. And I don't know what's going on here, God. She walked away. He walked away. They walked away. I lost my job. Where are the blessings of God? I don't see them. So this blessed life stuff, I don't buy it. Well, the truth is, God wants to bless your life. He really, really does. But you and I have the wrong concept of what true blessing is. Our concept of blessing is so shallow and so hollow that when you bite into it, it's empty. It's almost like that Easter bunny you buy, thinking, oh, I got a big chocolate bunny. You bite it, and it's hollow inside. Many times, that's what life is like with the promises that the world gives us. Well, how do we deal with this? How do we break free from the chokehold of money so it's not like you're living for the bills? Well, Jesus said this. He says, I say to you, make friends for yourself by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. Now, what is that supposed to mean? What? Well, let me explain. Just before we get to this verse, Jesus gives a parable of a gentleman that was working for a wealthy landowner, or wealthy executive, whatever you want to be at the time. And what happened was he wasn't doing his job very well, so he was going to get fired. He's like, oh my goodness. He's a bill collector. I got to collect all my debts from all these people. So if someone owed 1,000 bushels, hey, give me 500. And so he would like cut the deal. And he did all this. And the guy owner said, hey, this guy's pretty shrewd. And he's pretty smart. He knows that when he gets fired, people are going to like him and give him a job. Okay. And Jesus said, people of the world are a lot more shrewd than the sons of God. That was the context to talk about what he's talking about here, which we'll see in a few moments, okay? Just bear with me. You're going to get clear in a few moments. And I say to you, make friends for yourself by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you. He's given that parable, but now he's turning it over to a spiritual principle to teach us a lesson, his disciples and us today, that they may receive you into an everlasting home. By the end of today, you'll get what we're talking about here. But here's the principle. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters. Now, what is that supposed to mean? We don't have slavery, thank God, in America today. But back in the days of Christ, when this was happening, 65% or more were slaves. And so if the master owned you, the other master had no one had any rights to talk to you, because you were the complete own. You were owned by your master. And so what he's saying, and no servant can have two masters, he can't. You're either one or the other. We don't understand that today, so I'm just trying to help you understand. He's saying either you're with me or you're with the world. So no servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. Now, this is really important. You cannot serve God and mammon. And what this simply means is you can't serve God and mammon. You can't. I can't and you can't. Well, what's mammon? Well, hold on. We'll talk about it in a few moments. What is mammon? What is it? Well, it's only used 4 times in the entire Bible, this word. It's a word used by Jesus only 4 times, and 3 times in one passage and 1 time in a parallel passage found in Matthew. And so what is mammon? What is it? It's an Aramaic term. And what it means is this. Mammon is an Aramaic word which means riches, and mammon represents the spirit of this world. It comes from Mesopotamian, and it actually comes from the god of mammon, which is the god of wealth, god of will give you what you want. And it comes from the Mesopotamian area. If you think about it, the root of it and the root of the concept of mammon comes all the way back to Genesis when they were building the Tower of Babel. When they built the Tower of Babel, Babylon, Babel is confusion, okay, Babylon. Some of you, Babylon. But anyhow, That's a joke. Okay. What is mammon? So what it is they thought, we will be like God. We're going to make a name for ourselves. We're going to collect together. We don't need God. We will reach the heavens all by ourselves. We're going to make a great name for ourselves. So it's all about achieving your dreams without God. Okay, and that's what mammon is. It's the god of wealth. It's the god that you want. It's the thing that controls you. I want to be wealthy. I want to have riches. It's called mammon. You're saying, well, I'm not that way. I don't have any riches. Not a problem with me. Well, hold on. You'll see it in a few moments. So this is what mammon is. Now, the spirit of mammon wants us to serve it instead of God. Have you ever said this? I have. Man, if I don't get the money I needed, I'm really going to need God. Has anyone ever said that? Man, if we don't get the money we need, we're going to really need God. That statement is very telling. In other words, if we don't have the money, then we need God. It's awfully quiet in here today, which kind of shows us we're thinking that money's the answer. And if I don't have the money, then I'll go to God. You see, so the spirit of mammon wants us to serve it instead of God. I gotta work for the bills. I gotta work to get stuff. I wanna be successful. I wanna have the other in this. I wanna reach something. And listen, there's nothing wrong with wanting to be successful. It's a God-given desire. However, our concept of success is skewed by the god of mammon. The god of mammon wants to be humanly controlled and wants to make you the boss. The truth is, when you're the boss, you're a slave. Because you are not designed to rule yourself without God. You and I are designed to be in concert and to be connected to God. That's how we're designed. Outside of the design, it is destructive to you and other people. You see, you and I are designed by God for God. You're going to hear me say that all the time. So spirit of mammon wants us to serve it instead of God. Well, how do you know you have that? Well, has it ever happened to you? It has a personality on it. Do you ever try to take out your wallet to give something and money starts talking to you? You can't. No, don't give it away. You know what I'm talking about? It talks to you. The money talks to you. It has a personality. Mammon. Well, how does that work? Mammon is the spirit of Antichrist. Well, what is that supposed to mean? Ever hear of the Antichrist? The book of Revelation? Man of sin comes, you know? What's the Antichrist? What's mammon? Mammon is the god of wealth, god of I need, god of materialism, god of self-sufficiency, god of happiness, god of notoriety, god of comfort, god of peace. That it is a false god. And very interesting, look what it says in the Bible about it. Book of Revelation. And that no one may buy or sell except the one who has the mark of the name of the beast or the numbers of his name. Here is wisdom. You want to hear wisdom? Here's wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast. For it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. Six is the number of man. The trinity of man, 666, the number of the beast. There's going to come a time in our culture where you cannot buy or sell without giving in to the beast. You're thinking, I have the beast right now. I understand that. We are very much going that direction in the world. The Brexit vote slows it down with England. Our current election process, if they could, you know, get away from globalization. But globalization is on its way. You can't stop. It's happening. It's happening. Where one world government is coming. And one world monetary system is coming. The Bible predicted it. It's going to happen. And so what happens is in the end days, you're going to have to take the mark of the beast. And so in other words, there's going to come a point, I'm going to follow God or I'm going to follow the monetary God system of the world. It might come a point in time where we have to make a choice. The sad thing is, you don't realize it, and neither do I, that we're being controlled by this god of mammon. In fact, the wisest person that ever was, according to the Bible, was Solomon. And Solomon, remember Solomon, the wise king of Israel, son of David? He was amazing. He was the wisest man. He knew everything about everything. And God said, I will bless you. Everything he touched turned to gold. But there were certain things, prohibitions that he had to have. Number one, he could not get a lot of horses from Egypt. Do not marry foreign wives. And do not get too much gold. He blew all three off. Why? Because he wanted to have peace. As a wise man, he said, well, listen, you're better off having peace than having war. So he intermarried with other nations and made peace. And then he began to amass a fortune for himself. Tremendous amount of money. And by the end of his life, he was making idols to false gods. Now here's the wisest guy, not a wise guy, but a wisest guy in the world, one of the wisest ever in history. A man that was blessed by God who went off. How many of you think you're wiser than Solomon? One person, two people. God help you. But, you know, he was so wise, right? But what happened? Look what happened. The weight of the gold that came to Solomon every year was 666 talents of gold. This is not an accident in Scripture. This is a theological warning because the author of John and the Holy Spirit knew the thing that got Solomon was money. The god of money, mammon. And may I tell you today, if you and I are not careful, we could be right now deceived following the god of mammon. I'm not deceived. Well, how do you know you're not deceived? Because I'm not deceived. Let me ask you a question. What's the definition of being deceived? You don't know, right? So if you're deceived and you don't know you're deceived, it means you don't know you're deceived because you're deceived. You follow me? Or you need more coffee? The turkey nap is still happening here this morning. So when you're deceived, you don't know you're deceived. That's why it's always good to examine yourself. I believe very strongly that many of us, maybe me at times as well, is that we start worshiping the god of mammon, and like that good old frog in a kettle, I've never done it, I'm not that sick. But from what I understand, some of you have done this, I've never done it. You put a frog in some cold water and you warm it up slowly, and what happens to the frog, please don't do this, I'll get in trouble with the police and animal activists, but if you do this, apparently, you can cook a frog, he won't jump out. You put the frog in boiling water, it jumps right out. If you do it slowly, it gets cooked to death. Well, many of us are serving the god of mammon, the number of the beast, and we don't even realize it. Well, how do you know that? It's when money controls you and riches control you more than doing the will of God. That's when you know there's an issue. When it's time to give, it's stuck in my, I got some crazy glue in my pocket. I can't get the wall off my, and if you're afraid to tithe, you're afraid to give. And by the way, New Testament giving is 100%. It all belongs to God. The Bible says, you've been bought with a price. Your life is not your own. When you begin to think it's your own, you establish your own throne. When you think it's your own, you establish your own throne. And that is the spirit of Antichrist. And what could happen is this. If we're not careful, if we follow after the almighty dollar, you know, it says in our money, in God we trust. And unfortunately, it's true. We make money our God. And so what can happen is when the end times come, if we're connected so much to the god of mammon, we will be like that frog, not realizing that we're being sucked in to the world system, and we end up getting cold towards God and end up losing the opportunity to make a difference on the planet for him. And there's even worse things that can happen. So please understand, this god of mammon, you cannot serve god of mammon. This is some serious stuff. It got Solomon, it can get us. Be sober-minded and very, very sober-minded about this. Jesus says, no servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. When Jesus says you can't do it, guess what? You can't do it. Thank you very much. Now, is money evil? Is money evil? No, money's not evil. Can money be used for evil? Oh, absolutely. What does the Bible say? For the what? The love of money is a what? Root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from their faith. Yes, you can stray from your faith. And listen, when you stray, you don't realize you're straying. A number of years ago, I went to the beach. As you can tell, I got a nice tan. But I went to the beach, and I had my neighbor was with me, my neighborhood kid, and my parents brought us to the beach. My dad told me very, very, very carefully, can you see our blue umbrella, whatever color it was? This is where we're sitting here, okay? I want you to swim within the lifeguard zone right here. Okay, Dad, fine. So me and Clifford, the boy that I was playing with at the time, we just were, all of a sudden, we started straying because of the tide. And we were out there having a good old time, body surfing. And the next thing you know, I look up, oh my goodness, where am I? My mom and dad can't find us. My dad is frantic because he's a neighborhood kid. Now, this is back in the days when it didn't make a difference if you lost your child. Okay, I remember my parents would go to Sears and put me in the toy section. I'll see you later. And drop me off at Sears toy section and go to the rest of the mall and an hour later pick me up. Mom and dad, I'm still suffering from that. Now, if they would do that today, DCF would be all over you, right? But back in those days, when the horse and buggy days, it was not a problem doing that. But even in those days, my dad was upset because he couldn't find me or Clifford. A couple of hours, I would walk around the beach, could not be found. Finally, he found me, and I'm not going to tell you what happened, but he was never very happy. But what happened is I strayed without realizing it. My friends, it is a root of evil and in which some have strayed. You can stray from your faith by serving the God of Mammon and not even realize it. Why? It's all over us. It's like trying to avoid the air. You can't. The spirit of Mammon is our society. Materialism is all around us. I was just reading today in the paper before I got here that 35% of car owners are upside down on their loans. We keep on buying things we can't afford. So all kinds of evil from which some have strayed from the faith, and their greediness, and they've pierced themselves with many sorrows. Could it be the reason why we're seeing the doctor to deal with our broken heart is because we're following this God of Mammon? We're trying to be something. We're trying to be happy. We're trying to achieve something that cannot be achieved through normal human means. Now, what I did is I took you here. Now we're going to go back a little bit and bring the context of this verse. It's always good, by the way, when you hear a verse, go before and after to see the context of it. So we're going to see the context of this verse. Now, godliness with contentment is of great gain. Being content. When you realize that true happiness does not come from what you have, but who has you? Who has you? The God of Mammon or the God of all creation? God has me. I'm his responsibility. He'll take care of me. Now, godliness with contentment is of great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Bible is very, very clear about this, found in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Talks about that you have wood, hay, and you have precious metal. And so everything you do for yourself stays here. Everything you do for God is here and forevermore. And so why do you want to have godliness and not contentment? You see, godliness brings contentment. Because when you're godly, you're functioning in your normal design. You're functioning in the design that God's created you to have fellowship with him, to be blessed by him, so you can be a blessing to others. And that correlation of receiving and giving is a flushing like a river that is clean and pure and full of life. But if all you do is take, give me, my name is Jimmy, you become like a dead sea. Full of pus, full of amoeba, a sour, horrible water. And so now godliness with contentment is a great gain. So we brought nothing and carry nothing away. But those who desire to be rich, you're desiring to be something that only God can provide. There's nothing wrong with wanting to have nice things. But if that becomes the end all, get all, there's a problem. Happened to Solomon, can happen to you. But those who desire to be rich fall into what? Temptation and a snare. What's a snare? A trap. It's a trap. The God of mammon has put traps everywhere. Every time you turn on the television, every time you flip open your device, you're going to see it on the sidebar. Have this, have the other, have this. You go to the supermarket and you have all these painted models. And you have these guys that look like me with a big chest and a six-pack stomach. That's why I wear a vest to hide it, okay? There's a reason for what I'm doing here. But you can look at that. Yeah, I want to be this. I want to be that. Or even pastors can do the same thing. Oh, I got to be like the other guy down the street. And it becomes about a desire to be rich, a desire to have control. But the problem is you and I can't control without God. Without God, we are dangerous. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. Why? Because you are made by God. You only function properly when you're related to God and submitted to God. Otherwise, it doesn't work. I don't like that. Well, that's the way it is. A steering wheel is good in a car if it's submitted to the driver. If the steering gives out, you're going to crash the car. If you don't let God steer your life, you're going to crash. So desire to be rich, fall into temptation and a snare, and to many foolish and harmful lusts. It leads you down the path you don't want to go, which drown men. What a vivid picture. Drowning men in destruction and perdition. For, here we go. For what? The love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It's the love. It's the pursuit of money without God. It's not what you possess. It's what possesses you. For which some have strayed from the faith and the greediness and pierced themselves with many sorrows. One of the greatest problems of marriage is money issues, control issues. But you, O man of God, same passage of scripture, casually walk away from these things, and when you get around to it, try to be righteous. Is that what it says? No. What does it say? But you, O man of God, flee. It's like hot tail it, get out. It's a burning house. Leave everything behind. Now, why would God say that through the apostle? Why would the Holy Spirit say that through the apostle Paul? What, I mean, it's the same word, like it's the same vernacular in the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament, when it says that Joseph flee from Potiphar's wife. It's the same word. They use in the Greek. So it's saying run, like you would run from lust. Why? Because it can grab a hold of you like nothing else you believe. Believe me. How do you know that? Well, look at Solomon. Look what happened to him. The Antichrist, the mammon spirit, it is toxic. It is seductive. It is also slight. A little here, a little there. It's almost like, you know, I don't know what happened. I used to the other day, I had this apple pie. It was delicious. My mother said, you want a piece? No, I don't want a piece. I'll just have a little bit. So I sit there and I cut a little section of it and I have it. It's good. So I cut another little section I have and it's good. Before you know it, there's like a little bit left. I'm like, ah, the heck with it. I ate the whole thing. That's why I wear the vest. But the illustration is this. You don't realize how much you're eating. You take a little bit of time. I sure just took a big piece. All right, let's go on. What does it say here? Flee these things and pursue what? Pursue righteousness. What's righteousness? God's way. What does the Bible say? Seek what? First, the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all these things will be added to you. Okay. If you pursue God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Now, does that sound like bad stuff? Goodness, faith, love, patience, gentleness. Oh, that's legalistic. I mean, that sounds like life to me, right? Fight the good fight of faith. Lay a hold of eternal life. Listen, if you never get anything I tell you here, it's very, very important, aside from knowing Jesus Christ, is that you have to take your anchor and you have to throw it to eternity. Because we're only passing through this place. At your deathbed, you're not going to say, gee, I wish I bought that 4K television, the curved screen at Costco for $1,290, $2,100, whatever it was. Yeah, I saw it. I should have bought that. Oh, if I only would have got that massage chair at Brookstone. You know, you're not going to be thinking about all those things when you're dying. You'd be thinking about, I wish I had more time with my kids. I wish I made more of a difference, right? You're not going to be, you can't take that stuff with you. So, but you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay a hold of eternal life. You see, we have to do it. The only way you're going to live this life right is you have to live beyond this life. All the great men and women of faith saw a far-off country. They did not receive the promise in their lifetime, but saw it afar off, and they made great heights for the Lord Jesus Christ. If you look at a temporary sandcastle, why do you want to live in a sandcastle when you can live in a real castle? And see, my friends, fight the good fight of faith. Lay a hold of eternal light to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I don't know where I got this from, but I saw it. One life to live will soon be passed. Only what is done for Christ will last. And that's the truth. That's 1 Corinthians 13. One life to live, 1 Corinthians 3, excuse me. One life to live will soon be passed. Only what is done for Christ will last. Listen, it's a great place to live. It's a great place to live. I've been places when I've seen people so content in God, they're happy. I've said this before, but I remember going to Guatemala on my first mission trip, taking a 2.5-hour hike up this mountain, and these coffee groves are the best coffee I ever had. It was fantastic. Anyhow, I was up there, and there was these mud huts with grass for the roof, dirt floors, and these people were smiling. They had no idea they were poor. They loved God. They loved each other. They loved creation. And I wrote in my journal, these people are the wealthiest people I've ever met in my life because they had the joy of the Lord. Wealth is not what you own. It's who owns you. And if God owns you, you're wealthy. And you know it. One life to live will soon be passed. Only what is done for Christ will last. Now, we come back to the same passage again in Mark in a few moments. But before we do that, we're going to look at another passage of Scripture. There was a young man. You might have heard of him. The rich young ruler. This is the kind of guy you want on the church board. This is the kind of guy you want to hire as an assistant pastor. This is the kind of guy you want your daughter to marry. He's good looking. Has a nice physique, wears a vest. He's a good-looking guy, right? And thank you. All right. My wife says, pull your shoulders back. Okay. It makes you look before, after. All right, here we go. Now that he was going out to the road, one came running and knelt before him and asked him, good teacher. Now, this is the rich young ruler. This guy had it all together. He knew the Bible well. He was good looking. He was known in the community. He was a rich young ruler. And so there's three passages of Scripture. Look at this. We're looking at the Mark's version of it. Good teacher. He came running. He came running and knelt before him and asked him, good teacher, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? What happened? The God of mammon wasn't meeting his needs. He realized, I want to have real wealth. And so he saw Jesus had something he didn't have. So he ran after Jesus. Maybe you run to church, right? You run out. You know Scripture. You're running after church. That's what happened here. And so Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. He's going to see if he knows who he is, that he's God. Then, you know the commandments, Jesus says, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and your mother. And he answered and said to him, teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth. He did everything right. You and I would say he's it. He's the cat's or dog's bark. Forget the cat's meow. Okay, he's got it together. Wow, this guy's amazing. He's an amazing guy. He knows the commandments. He's wealthy. He's good looking. Come over to our house for dinner. I want you to marry my daughter so I can have an inheritance. When I retire, I'll be taken care of by this guy. I mean, this is the kind of guy he was, right? Teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth. So he had all the spirituality, but there was something hollow inside of him. Then Jesus looking at him, this is what I love. Jesus looked at him and was ticked off. No, Jesus looking at him, loved him. Jesus is looking at you, and he loves you. He loves you. Every single one of you, he loves you. He loves you watching at home, wherever you are. He loves you. And he loves you so much, he doesn't want to see you waste your life serving a false god, getting into heaven with nothing to show for it, or missing heaven altogether. This guy was missing heaven. He loved religion. He loved the church world. He loved the morality. He loved all these wonderful things. He loved going to church. He loved scripture. He enjoyed it. But guess what? He was in charge and God wasn't. And that's why in that day, we're going to be surprised. Lord, Lord, I was a pastor of a church. I preached on giving. I don't know who you are. Depart from me. I never knew you. You can live a mirage. You can live the Christian life and have never surrendered your life completely to God because you had the final word, not God. If you never say I'm wrong to anybody and you never have any mistakes in your life, you could be a candidate for a person like this. Because a person that is saved by grace knows who they are. As Dr. Tim Keller says, I'm paraphrasing this, you are more evil than you ever could dream of, and you're more loved than you dared to hope. We don't realize who we are without God. And so he went, loved him, and said to him, one thing you lack. What's the one thing he lacked? Go your way, sell whatever you have, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come and take up the cross and follow me. But he was sad at this word and went away sorrowful like a heroin addict that has to get the next fix. I can't go through the withdrawals of not being in control. Why does the Bible say flee from the love of money? Because it's a toxin that will make you an addict. And you can be full of track marks of materialism. And you can come to church. You can be a pastor. You can be an executive in the church world. You can even be a missionary and you're doing all the right stuff, but you're in charge and God's not. I will have no other gods before me. You either hate the one or love the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. How much clearer can we get? Maybe some of us are going away sorrowful. We have all the right stuff. Why am I so depressed? Why am I so down? Now, I'm not saying that if anyone's depressed, it's for this reason, but it could be. Because you haven't surrendered. You're living for the God of mammon. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how hard. Jesus is grieved. He's grieved. Is he grieved today with us? He looks at you in love, says, listen, there's a better way for you guys. How hard it is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God. And you're thinking, I wish I had a hard time with riches. I have no riches. I can barely wear britches. Okay? I don't have any riches. So this doesn't really apply to me, Pastor. If I had some money, then maybe we could talk. Well, hold on. You'll see it in a few moments. He said this. How hard is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle. No, it's not a gate in Jerusalem. It's literally an eye of a needle. That's what he's talking about here. Than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples are flipping out. Because why? Because the rich were seen as blessed by God. Especially if they were religious. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Oh, what will a man give in exchange for his soul? And they were greatly astonished, saying among themselves, who can be saved? I can't do this, Jesus. You know, when the moment you come to the conclusion you can't do it is the moment you are at the opportunity for real freedom. If you think you can do this thing all by yourself, then you are probably deluded. You can't do this by yourself. You're designed by God for God. It doesn't work without God. Now, but Jesus looked at the man and said, with men, it is impossible. The God of mammon is all about man. With men, it's impossible, but not with God. For with God, all things are possible. You mean you can trust God with your finances? Absolutely. The Bible says, test me and see if not, I will open the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing, you will not be able to contain it. Does it necessarily mean that Lamborghinis and Ferraris and Shelby Cobra Mustangs are going to come down, I hope? No, it doesn't mean that. True riches is a state of mind. You see, the reason you have riches and wealth is so you can be happy. So you can feel secure and important. Money is trying to afford these luxuries of a state of mind. But God gives you that state of mind without all the nonsense before it. You don't have to change the oil on your happiness with God. You don't have to pay mortgage payments with that. With men, it's impossible. But not with God. I'm going to ask the worship team to make their way up, please. For with God, all things are possible. Now listen to this. He who is faithful in what is least is also faithful in much. So you say, I have no money. You know, a dear friend of our family and one of our mentors had a great impact on me. You met him. His name is Jake Bergman. He actually spoke here on a Sunday morning back this past fall or wherever it was. And he was a school teacher, and he went to start selling investments. And he's a Jewish guy. He was Jewish. He met my father. My father led him to the Lord 6 months using the Bible. He came to know Christ. He started working for an investment firm. And my dad said, hey, you give your life to Christ, you need to start tithing. My dad's very blunt. That's where I get it from, that bluntness part. And he goes, what do you mean? Well, give God 10% at least. You know, that's where you start. You bring your tithe. I can't do that. I'm only making X amount of dollars a week. As my dad said, if you can't do it making $600 a week, then if you make a million, you won't be able to do it. Little did he realize he would become a millionaire. And so he actually told me, multimillionaire, he said to me, you know, your dad told me that, I never forget that. And I never forgot that. I always tithe, always trusted God. He became a multimillionaire. He lost it all. Gained most of it back. Then God called him to the ministry. He, 100 times, he left his salary behind, sold everything he had, and he made a pastor's salary for 12 years. I'm going to serve God, not the God of mammon. He learned that he's not going to be controlled by that, and he fled from it. He was honest with me. He said, sometimes I struggle because I see stuff. No, he knew enough. Do you know enough to flee from the God of mammon? So he's faithful in what is least is also faithful in much. If God can't trust you with $5, he's not going to trust you with $50,000. If God can't trust you with $50,000, he's not going to trust you with $100,000 or $500,000. Yes, I believe we're to be blessed to make a difference in the world, but money's not the answer. God is the answer. And everything we have to be willing to let it go. If we can't let it go, then it owns us. Therefore, if you have not been faithful and the unrighteous mammon, who will commit you with the true riches? God wants to give you riches, true riches, not the phony stuff we see, not the stuff you drive and buy and walk in. True riches is peace, love, joy, a relationship with God, and yes, and this world beyond. This earth is a big job interview. One day, we're going to have tremendous opportunities in heaven. You will not be on a cloud. You'll be doing amazing things for God. And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what's your own? Listen, are you willing to die to the God of mammon? How about we, like, evict the God of mammon in our lives? I'm not going to follow this God of mammon, this Antichrist spirit. Jesus says, no servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the other and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one and the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You and I have to make a choice. Now you know better, and I know better. Let's remember what this is about. And I say to you, make friends for yourself by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. Now we're going back to the context of this passage of Scripture, where we have this story, this parable. And what he's basically saying here is this. He gave the illustration of the guy being shrewd in the world. You know, I'll pay half. and that when you lose your job, they'll receive you. We say, you know what? There's a lot, something better than that. Forget about the mammon of riches of the earth. I'm talking about people, that you and I get to make a difference with people, that one day I'm going to hear someone run up to me and say, thank you. Some Muslim in Indonesia is going to come up to me and say, my whole family was saved. Why? Because you gave to that missionary. I had no idea I did that. Someday someone's going to come from Teen Challenge and say, thank you. I got off heroin and now I'm free. And I made it to heaven because of you. Why? Because you supported Teen Challenge. You do not know the difference you can make. And so I say to you, make friends for yourself by unrighteous mammon. Take this mammon. Money has a personality. Whatever you give to God, whatever drives your money is the God of your money. If you're driving your money, the God of mammon drives your money. If you give your money to God, then it's God's money and it's blessed. Give the first to God. Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where is your heart? Where is my heart? Is it on God or is it on the God of mammon, of things, position, power, accolades? I don't know about you, but I will not serve the God of mammon. And when he comes running around, I'm going to run from him because it's destructive. Jesus says this, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. And I will go out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and destroy. The enemy wants to kill you, your children, your legacy, your family. He wants to take you out. And if he can use the God of mammon, he'll use it. Christ has come. I have come that they may have Zoe, life, and that they may have it more abundantly. God wants you to have a blessed, abundant life. But the abundance he wants to give you is not shallow, not hollow. It is something that cannot be shaken or taken away from you. How would you like to build yourself on something that no economy, no difficulty, no health issue can take away? The solid rock of Jesus Christ. We want to build our life on that. That's what makes the difference. And he wants to give you and I an abundant life. But it only comes through rejecting the God of mammon and receiving Almighty God himself through Jesus Christ, our only Lord and Savior. Let's bow our heads. I don't know where you are today. Maybe you're the rich young ruler. Maybe you've been coming to church. Maybe you understand it all. You can quote scripture. You got it all together. I don't know. Maybe you've never even been in church before. Maybe you've only been in church several times. And somehow, some way today, you've been stirred. You don't understand if it's emotion. What's going on with me? I believe God is calling you to himself because you are made by God for God. And your spirit is crying out saying, I want the real. I don't want the fake. I want to connect to what will make me whole. Not only now, but forever. And there's something in you calling out to you. I believe that's the Holy Spirit. And today, it's real simple. You don't have to get your act together first. It's like if you can't pay your mortgage and someone comes to you and says, I'll take the mortgage off you. All you have to do is sign it over. My friends, you have a mortgage you cannot pay. It's called sin. And Jesus Christ has paid your mortgage of your life in full. When he put his arms on the cross, he said, it is finished. It is paid in full. Question is, are you going to let him take your debt away? So, if you'd like to do that today, I'm going to ask you to pray a prayer with me. The prayer is not magical. No, the heart connecting to God is what does it. It's so simple, so profound. You can begin a new journey today. So if you want to keep your eyes closed and we're going to pray, I'm going to ask everyone to be quiet here. This is an important time here. The band can still play. It's fine. But Lord Jesus, I thank you for dying on the cross for me. I believe you are the way, you are the truth, you are the life. I recognize that you have not been first place in my life. I ask you right now to take away all of my sins of me being the boss, I declare my life is no longer my own. I hand my life over to you. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins, both known and unknown. And from this day forward, with your help, I will walk the path you have for me in a relationship. Fill me now with your Spirit in Jesus' name. With every head bowed, just so I know how to pray for you better, say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer this morning. Just anyone this morning, you want to raise your hand? Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? 4 or 5 of you, come on. Let's thank God this morning that God's working in people's hearts. It's a beginning. But let's pray for the rest of us today. Maybe we've been deceived. Let's just go pray right now. Father, in Jesus' name, let's come in agreement when I'm praying. Father, we declare we will not serve the God of mammon in Jesus' name. We reject the God of wealth. We reject the God of position. We reject the God of mammon, and we choose this day to only worship the one true God, which is found through Jesus Christ. Lord, we choose to serve you. We reject the Antichrist spirit. We reject materialism. We reject stinginess, and we choose to be blessed. Freely you have received, now freely give. And so, Father, we receive that today. I ask you to break the spirit of poverty off of every single person in this place. As we release everything we have to you and entrust you, I ask you to bless every single person at the sound of my voice in Jesus' name, because these are not my words. These are the words of you, God, that will last forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word endures forever. So, Lord, we ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Listen, look up here real quick. If you raise your hand today and says, my commitment today, I'm renewing my commitment or making a new commitment. Please, we want to help you in this journey. We collect these and we're going to contact you. We're not going to bother you, but we're going to contact and help you on this journey. In a few moments, the ushers are going to come and they're going to collect these cards along with our offerings this morning. Okay, so you want to take a moment to fill that out. If you have any prayer concerns, whatever, this is the way we stay connected. Okay? A couple of things I want to say. If you've given your life to Christ and you've never been baptized, you can get baptized. 2 weeks from now, on December the 11th, both services, we're going to have a baptism right here during the services. We're going to have a baptism where you say, I'm giving my life to Christ completely. A lot of you gave your life to Christ, but you've not said it publicly through baptism. So I want to encourage you to do that. Okay, everybody? At this time, let's go ahead and prepare ourselves for our giving as well. The ushers, please come forward as we pray for the offering right now. Father, we just thank you so much. You've blessed us. How could we not give back what you've already given to us? Lord, we bless you. I pray you bless these tithes and these offerings, Father. We thank you that when we entrust you with what we have, you can entrust us. And I ask blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead, ushers. Please, you can do that. A couple of the housekeeping things as we're doing that. Listen, if you've been coming to our church for a period of time, we want to see you fulfilled. We believe you're designed by God for God to make a difference in the world. And we believe you learn to make a difference in church because we're family here. Just like children learn how to work in the real world, well, in church, you can learn how to work and find your gifts. And so we have a class today. It's called Serve. You can become part of the Dream Team today. We have a lunch for you right on the right-hand side. It's a conference room. It says Grove Track Step 4 Serve. We have a lunch. We have extra food available and childcare. Hey, have lunch on us. Why have the turkey leftovers? We can have fresh food. Love to have you come today. You're going to hear about the different ministries that are available in church. You can come today. Next week is our membership class. So love to have you guys come. And also what we're going to do, we're going to have a closing song. As we do that, we're going to ask the prayer team to come up. If you need prayer for anything at all, we want to be able to pray with you and come in agreement. Okay, everybody, let's all stand if we could as we sing this final song.
Every child. God bless you and keep you. Let's walk in His freedom today. We're going to leave the front open for prayer. Otherwise, we dismiss you guys. Be blessed so you can be a blessing. God bless you guys. Thank you.
Where are you going? Oops, turn this off.